So today let's take a look at not my cat, but this traffic light. It's actually not a traffic light, it's a garage parking sensor. It's useful especially if you are not very good at driving. You can install it on the wall in your garage and it will give you a red light if you are about to hit the wall. I've got it for Christmas, it's a very nice gift, but there is just one problem. I do have a car, but I have no garage. So I've got only one possible use for it. Take it to bits in my channel. So let's unbox it. And there is the traffic light. It looks very nice. Almost like a real traffic light. There is the sensor, probably an ultrasonic sensor, and some batteries for it. Four AA batteries. Some manual, which nobody reads. And some screws to install it. So let's try to put the batteries in it. There is a battery space for four AA batteries. Let's put the cover back. And there is a switch on it. So let's turn it on. And it's doing something. Red light. Still red light. Now green. Red. Yellow. Green. Yellow, red. So it seems to work. So if the distance is 1.5 to 5 meters, it's green. 0.5 to 1.5 meters, it's yellow. And less than half a meter, it's red light. So it seems to have an ultrasonic sensor, which is alternating between a transmitter and a receiver. It will send an ultrasonic sound. Basically just a short burst of ultrasound like this. And it will reflect and come back. So it will transmit a short burst of ultrasonic sound, then it will switch to a receiver and wait for it to come back. The ultrasound will bounce off your car or anything else and come back with a delay. The sensor will measure the delay and calculate the distance. The speed of sound is about 340 meters per second. But the sound has to travel the distance twice. So 1 second is going to be about 170 meters. Or 1 millisecond is going to be about 17 centimeters. So half a meter is about 3 milliseconds and 1.5 meters is about 9 milliseconds. So it shows green if the delay is over 9 milliseconds. It shows yellow if it's 3 to 9 milliseconds. And it shows red if it's under 3 milliseconds. I wonder, is the cat able to hear it? But she doesn't seem to care at all. So it seems to be working well, and now I noticed I can actually hear some clicking or ticking from it. Can you hear it too? It's like tick, 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 about 3 times per second. So it seems to be working in pulses. If there is no motion for about half a minute, it will turn off the LED and change the pulsing pattern to save the battery probably. So let's try to measure how much current does it draw. So it's about 15 milliamps when it's active. I'm trying to measure the standby current, but my kit keeps activating it. Now it's in standby and the current is almost zero, 0.01 milliamps. Now it makes some pulses, about half a milliamp. And now it's active again. But now, of course, let's take a look inside. So here's the cover of it. And here you can see the board with those LEDs, a switch and a connector with a cable. It seems almost empty. It looks like there are just the LEDs, the switch, the batteries, and most of the electronics are in the other half. So let's remove the board from it to see the other side of it. And there are three transistors and some resistors, and that's it. Just transistors switching those LEDs, but no chip. There is one resistor at the switch, some components here, and the connector. So it looks like three transistors to switch those LEDs, three resistors in series with them, and three base resistors. So this is more or less the entire board. And when I take a look at this connector, I can see some marking. It says ground, yellow, red, green, and plus 4.5 volts. Even though there are four batteries, so shouldn't it say 6 volts? And that's weird. The marking is on either side. So the cable contains ground, positive, and the signals for those three LEDs. So this one is just a display board with batteries, and the most interesting part must be here. So let's take a look in it. And that's it. I can see the ultrasonic transducer, a 4 MHz crystal, two inductors, three electrolytic capacitors, and no chip. So it has to be from the other side. Let's take a look. So there is quite a lot of it from the other side. Two chips, 14 pins each. There is another chip, maybe a regulator or just a power transistor. Another 6 or 7 transistors in a tiny package, and a lot of resistors, capacitors, diodes, and that's it. The chips are TLC, TU74C, and the other one is HW3101. And this one is something like 7130-1 or 7130C-1 or -4. It's not very easy to read. So let's see a better picture of it. And now, reverse engineering time. So let's take a look at the schematic of it. So it's quite complex today, and as you can see, it's a bloody mess. Normally I draw a schematic twice. First I draw the preliminary schematic while reverse engineering it, and then I draw the final schematic, which is much nicer. But today it's a bit too complicated and I'm not going to draw it for the second time. I don't know exactly what each component is doing, but I have some rough idea what's going on here. And there is a microcontroller, which I can't find a datasheet of, but it doesn't matter. It must be some kind of microcontroller with 14 pins. The positive is number 4, the negative is number 11. And there is an op-amp, it's a quadruple op-amp, basically 4 op-amps in one package. It is TLC TU74C. And there is some voltage regulator, it's a low dropout, low power voltage regulator, which is regulating 3 volts for the microcontroller probably. And there is just a lot of capacitors in parallel to the power. And the actual ultrasonic transducer is this one. And there is some driving circuitry, and it seems that the microcontroller can drive it using those two transistors. They are connected as a Darlington transistor for higher amplification, and there is a driving transformer driving this ultrasonic transducer, some protection zeners or so, and so when it's transmitting, it's actually driving it using this amplifier and this transformer. When it's receiving, the signal from it goes via this resistor into this op-amp, which is amplifying it. It looks like the first op-amp has one input here and the other one here, and here is the output. And there is some resonant circuit, so it's probably tuned to receive just one frequency. And this is the output, and it goes into another circuitry with the second op-amp. And there is some low-pass filter or high-pass filter or band-pass filter further filtering it, and the output of the second op-amp goes into the third op-amp, the last one. And there is the other input of it, which I'm not sure what it's doing. And the output goes via a diode and a resistor into the microcontroller. And there are some pins of the microcontroller going into the circuitry via some resistors of different values. So is the microcontroller switching the sensitivity of the receiver or something like this? Maybe. And this pin is probably the main input of the microcontroller, and so when the reflected signal comes back, it probably makes an impulse here and it goes into the microcontroller. And this one will calculate the time and measure the distance. There is a crystal oscillator, which is quite common for a microcontroller, and there is some strange circuitry. It's probably a blanking circuitry. It's disabling the reception when it's transmitting or something like this. Because when it's driving this amplifier, it also drives this transistor, and this one actually drives this one, and this one will probably disable the receiver or something like this. And there is another transistor with a resistive divider. So is it monitoring the voltage of the battery somehow via this transistor to recognize when the battery is flat? Maybe, because I have no other explanation for this circuitry. And there is some, let's call it a standby circuitry, because this microcontroller can actually turn this or pump off. The microcontroller can turn on this transistor and it will turn on this one. And this one will power up this op-amp. So it can actually go into standby and this one has no power. The transmitting amplifier has some resistor in series and some capacitors in parallel. This is probably a filter to prevent backfeeding the signal into the power rails. So it seems to be quite complex. There is a voltage regulator, microcontroller, some voltage sensing. This is disabling the reception. This is a standby circuitry to turn this one off when it's not active. There is the transmission circuitry with the amplifier and the transformer. Some protective zeners. And this one is switching the sensitivity or something like this. And this one is a tuned oscillator, not oscillator, it's a tuned circuitry. And another filters. The amplifier has three stages. There are four op-amps, but one is not in use. And the microcontroller has three outputs for the LEDs. And they are going into those three transistors, some series resistors and those LEDs. And there's the battery and a switch and a discharging resistor. So when you turn it off, it will discharge those capacitors into this resistor. So is this transistor actually sensing the voltage of the battery or is it sensing when this transistor is on? But the microcontroller should know when it's on because it's actually driving it. So it's probably sensing the voltage of the battery. I'm not sure what this circuitry is doing. Is it some timing circuitry or is it making some delay between the transmission and reception or is it ramping up the sensitivity? So the sensitivity is actually growing in time because the longer the signal actually has to travel, the weaker it is, maybe. So as you can see, it's really quite complex. I think it's the most complicated device in this channel so far. So here you can see the datasheet of the op-amp with the pinout and other parameters. And this one wasn't so hard to find. There is also the datasheet of the voltage reference, I mean voltage regulator. And this one is a 3 volt version. But I wasn't able to find the datasheet of the microcontroller. Here's the manual, which is completely useless. There is absolutely no useful information. There is something about electric shocks, even though it's not running off mains, it's running off batteries. There is something about not giving the plastic bag to children. Keep away from children, keep away from something like crazy people or mad individuals. Something about swallowing a battery. Risk of death if you swallow a battery. Okay, that's interesting. There is something about the disposal. And it's talking about disposing fluorescent tubes. Are you kidding me? Something about a risk of fire and a danger for people who are insane and something like this. And there is absolutely no useful information like the operating frequency and the angle of this sensor and something like battery life or battery power consumption. So this entire pile of paper is basically just to prevent you from suing them if something happens to you. But anyway, it's an interesting device which can be useful, but there is just one question. What's the point of putting this in your garage if you can put the same type of device into your car and have it always with yourself? When it's in your garage, it's only giving you signals when you go into the garage, but when it's in your car, it's giving you signals everywhere you go. But it may be useful to prevent somebody else from demolishing your garage. The grommet is loose on the cable. That's not very nice. Let's put a super glue on it. And it's all back together. So this is Diagon Wild, and see you in my next videos. It could also be an alarm if you connected some beeper to those LEDs. Beep, 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 beep.